Spotted lanternfly. If you live in the Northeast, chances are you're quite familiar with these little guys, and you've probably heard that they're causing a lot of problems.
But where did they come from? I recently went home to New Jersey and could not walk 5 steps without seeing dozens of them. When I went to the beach, the rack line was littered with their bodies.
But I spent my childhood in the good old dirty Jers, and I'd never encountered a single one until a few years ago. So, what gives?
Lycorma delicatula, sorry to all of you Latin speakers out there, is currently found in 19 states and the District of Columbia.
19. Though most of us have not seen them until a few years ago, they've actually been in the United States for more than a decade. The first of these was found in Pennsylvania in 2014. Since then, their numbers have grown exponentially, currently being estimated at ? Who knows? We don't even have an estimate for the innumerable number of these invasive insects in the states today.
So, what happened? Where is this going? And what can we do about it? Let's find out together.
Where did they come from? The spotted lanternfly is native to Southeast Asia, specifically southern China, Vietnam, and Taiwan. It began to spread in the early 2000s to South Korea and Japan, and then later to the United States. Guess they decided it was time for a vacation. It was almost certainly introduced to this new turf via imported goods, unbeknownst to those carrying them.
Hi everyone, I'm Tessa. I have a PhD in hydrology, which basically means you can call me a water doctor, and I currently work in landscape ecology. I'm here to talk to you about science. So the spotted lanternfly is considered an invasive species, but not just because it's non-native. What makes some non-native species also invasive? It's the adverse effects that they cause. From the National Park Service, an invasive species is a non-native species that causes harm to the environment, economy, or human, animal, or plant health. It's often thought that the terms invasive and non-native can be used interchangeably, but that's not always the case.
Compared to the growth of most invasive species, the spotted lanternfly has had an explosion in their population and spread. To quote Matthew Gallo of the Finger Lakes chapter of the Partnership for Regional Invasive Species Management, or PRISM,
"Gypsy moths took about 100 years to move from Massachusetts to New York. Spotted lanternflies are now in 10 states in just 7 years. And in the past 4 years, that number has nearly doubled."
How is this possible? Well, let's take a look at their life cycle.
The life cycle of a spotted lanternfly is as follows. Adults lay eggs in the fall, which hatch the following spring. As they grow, they go through 4 distinct life phases, known, oh so creatively, as the first, second, third, and fourth instars. Instar is a term that means a stage in the life of an arthropod, such as an insect, between successive molts.
This is what they look like. Surprised? I was too. In fact, here is a video of me having absolutely no idea that I was looking at a young spotted lanternfly. That was a fourth instar. These things look like Pokemon evolutions. Like, they're so distinct and like, how do they turn into, After just a few short months, they become adults and lay their own eggs in the fall. They don't live very long, thankfully, with a lifespan of about less than a year. But once they lay their eggs, their primary mission is complete. Why do they matter?
So, what's the big deal? Why does everybody freak out about this? Should I be concerned? Well, just relax and let me explain.
Spotted lanternflies are plant hoppers, not flies, believe it or not. They hop from surface to surface and hold on tightly when they land. Immediately after hatching, they begin to feed on woody plant species. Its favorite snack is the ailanthus tree, commonly known as the tree of heaven, which is itself an invasive species. But that is certainly not all that it eats. The insect has been documented feeding on more than 70 different species, including maples, oaks, grapevines, and apple trees. So how does this tiny insect feed on bark-covered trees? Well, they use piercing mouthparts to access sap beneath a tree's bark. After feeding, they excrete a substance called honeydew, a sticky, sugary liquid comprised of partially digested sap that attracts other harmful insects, promotes sooty mold growth, and further damages the plants. The sooty mold growth fungus that grows stresses the tree, leaving it vulnerable to other diseases and pests, and disrupts photosynthesis, stunting the growth and overall health of the tree. In the case of plants like grapevines and apple trees, the mold also affects the look, taste, and smell of the fruit. In their native habitat, spotted lanternfly populations are controlled by predators, mostly varieties of parasitic wasps. But here, it's largely up to us. Of course, like with all things in the environment, everything is linked. The damage to these trees and forests could destroy habitat for countless other species. Bats, birds, mammals, and reptiles that rely on woody vegetation for habitat and food can be seriously impacted. And there's more. The Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture reports that, if left uncontrolled, these little buggers could cost the state $324 million annually and more than 2,800 jobs. And that's just Pennsylvania alone. So, what should we do? Thankfully, spotted lanternflies cannot bite and are not physically dangerous to humans. But as you can see, the rapid spread of these invasives is a serious issue.
So, what's the solution? Well, for most of us, it's simple. Turn the spotted lanternfly into a swatted lanternfly. Get it?
When you see them, play a good old game of whack-a-mole and smash, smash, smash.
It's a fucking battlefield up here.
As somebody who cares deeply about the environment, harming an animal felt very wrong at first. But when you understand how much damage you are helping to prevent, you know it is the right thing to do. Use your shoes or whatever else to squash them. Here is a video of me doing just that. Another, thankfully, is that they are not difficult to spot, being pretty large at approximately an inch long by half inch wide with very distinct, visually striking colorings and patterns at all stages of life. You can also remove any trees of heaven on your property, which, as we mentioned, are invasive and harmful anyway. Also, due to their life cycle, you will mainly find them in late spring, all of summer, and early fall, so you should get a natural break from them for a lot of the year.
During the other part of the year, you have a different mission, should you choose to accept it.
Identifying the insects may not be very difficult, but spotting egg masses is something else entirely. The USDA wrote,
"Newly laid egg masses holding 30 to 50 eggs resemble wet, gray putty before turning dull and brown, mirroring a smear of cracked mud. The 1-inch long egg masses can be seen in fall, winter, and spring on a variety of smooth surfaces, such as trees, bricks, stones, fences, grills, equipment, and vehicles. For the bugs themselves, it's just smash and report if they are in large numbers somewhere that they are not expected to be. But for eggs, it's smash and scrape. Smash eggs and scrape them off, ideally into a plastic zippered bag filled with hand sanitizer or rubbing alcohol to kill them. Then zip the bag shut and throw it in the trash. If you're heading into or out of a spotted lanternfly quarantine area, be particularly vigilant. If you aren't sure where these are, use this interactive map from Cornell's Integrated Pest Management Program. Neat! Before leaving, check your vehicle for eggs or insects. Also, inspect any items being moved. Fall is the most critical time to check because you may be unknowingly transporting egg masses, which would be bad, obviously.
For more serious infestations, there are treatment measures that can be taken. Contact an expert about that, not me, and they can help.
I'm not gonna pretend to tell you anything about that. But for most of us, it's swatted lanternfly time, baby! But seriously, it's important that we all try and help out. Yes, in many ways it is a losing battle, but every bit that we fight back helps. The thickest armor can be pierced by a spear of true grit. Or something like that. Researchers are actively looking for new ways to control lanternfly populations, so all hope is not lost. Every bit that we fight back helps to give scientists a fighting chance to do their work before things get out of control. They are causing a lot of damage and spreading rapidly, so help us all out and do your part.
And I will see you next time. Ciao.